Yves Punie, welcome to Eden. Thank you for your keynote presentation this morning. One of the things you talked about was digital competency. Could you tell us a little bit more about what you mean by that?
Thanks a lot also, Steve, first of all. So first, what I wanted to argue in my keynote is indeed that I think learners and citizens need digital competences to participate and to live and to participate in our society. Now, obviously, people speak about digital competence, digital skills, e-literacy, e-skills, etc. There are many, many different terms around. And what we did actually at GRC is we did a research project to try to define and describe more exactly what digital skills are. And we define it as digital competence because competence is a broader term than skills. Competence means knowledge, skills, and attitudes, as defined in the European Qualifications Framework. So it's a bit of a broader kind of term, first of all. And then secondly, so we did a lot of research, and then we did also a lot of consensus building to somehow agree upon the question, what are the most important digital competences that people need today? And we came up with a list of 21 competences. We structured them into five competence areas. And very briefly, I will talk you through them because I think they're also important for learners, not just for citizens, for everybody. Is that first of all, is being able to deal with information and data. Being able to find information, being able to assess and critically evaluate information. So that's one competence area. The second one, obviously, is being able to communicate through digital means, to be able to communicate and collaborate and share with other people. That also has to do, for example, with an etiquette, with the norms and values, because if you engage in an online conversation, you need to understand also the norms and the values and the cultural considerations as well, which are important. So you need to know about these things. The third area is content creation. I mean, people more and more upload information, videos, photos, etc., etc. So that also in the learning environment, of course, becomes more and more important. So how to create content and how to share and collaborate together, create joint content. The fourth area is about safety, which is of course very important. I mean, safety about data, personal data, safety of privacy, but also physical and health well-being, because we know there are examples of youngsters being harassed through online means, and so we need to be able to deal with that and make sure that people don't get into problems related to that. Safety of devices as well. And then the fifth area is what we call problem solving, which goes from the most basic, everybody has to solve some technical problems when we engage with digital technologies, but it goes more also to think about what are the digital skills that I need today, so also to become more reflexive about your capacities to use digital technologies in the modern world, basically. So these are the, yeah.
One of the surprising statistics you mentioned this morning, Yves, was 37% of the European workforce are lacking in digital competence. What can be done to address that problem?
Well, you will continue to have significant skills mismatches where companies will not find the people with the right skills and competences to do properly the jobs they have to do. Now, probably there also, on the one end, you could say that education has to provide the solutions to that, and that's partly true, but there is also, I think, a role for companies to play as well. It's too easy to say and to blame everything on education. I mean, especially also, I mean, companies also need to train and retrain people and give the opportunities for people to retrain. For example, we have some data in the survey we did with MOOC learners, and there actually, surprisingly, we find out that it was a pilot study, about 3,000 MOOC learners, about five, six different MOOCs, is that almost half of them who are workers, they follow MOOCs without their employer knowing about it. So that's a bit of an intriguing kind of result. And on the other hand, what we find out is that in those cases where the employer knows about or supports learning, training opportunities of their staff, actually they engage less in MOOCs, but more in traditional physical kind of training opportunities. So there are still some challenges to address as well.
Many challenges, I think, that we have to face. I think Derek Bock once said, if you think education is expensive, then try ignorance. And I think this is exactly what we're talking about here, isn't it? Yves, thank you very much for your time today.
It's a pleasure. Thank you, Steve.